talking with Kenny Burrell. He's been playing an engagement at the El Matador, and of course he's been around for many years playing numerous recording dates, probably the best known jazz guitarist for record dates. He's been playing what, how many years now?
About 20, 21.
Well, where have you been playing these days?
All over the world lately, since June of last year, which is 69. I've been to Europe 4 times. I was in Japan this year for a tour. Not all over the world, but Japan and Europe and here.
And you travel with what usually?
Different groups. Once I went with my own quartet, and I went over with a package which included the Thad Jones Band, Jeremy Steig, Freddie Hubbard, myself, and I went over with the Newport Jazz All-Stars.
So you've been keeping real busy in that?
I've been traveling a lot more than I was before.
Uh-huh.
I mean, globally.
How about recording?
I'm going to do a few albums with Cadet coming up shortly, and I'm in the middle of negotiating with some other people, which I can't say right now, but I do have a commitment from Cadet to do a couple of albums.
Uh-huh. How did you like doing those old dates? Seemed like almost every Blue Note record that came out for a while, Jimmy Smith and, you know, so many dates back there where you were playing guitar. Was that just a short period of time, or?
That was from about 57 to about 63. It's about 6 years. I did a lot of recording. I guess I did more recording in those 6 years than anybody else in the business. Jazz recording and pop recording. Then I started going on the road in 63. As a result of the album called Midnight Blue.
Mm.
That sort of launched me into a position where I could get my own group and go on the road.
And did he get a big hit off it, or?
Not really. The album just was a good album. It sold a lot, you know.
Thank you.
On those Blue Note dates, were things written out much for you, or did you just did you have all the charts in front, or did you just run it down with the group?
Both.
And I'm sure everyone was different, but
both ways. Sometimes the music was written. Sometimes we just saw. A lot of times when Jimmy and I went in, Jimmy Smith and I, we just sort of said, well, what we're going to play, and we decided on a key and we started to play.
We sit around Rudy Van Gelder's for a few hours, I guess.
Yeah.
I used to have for my theme the organ grinder swing, and one of your
best
solos of all time.
Thank you.
How'd that one come about?
Well, Jimmy heard that tune from somewhere. And he came to the record date that day. He said, well, I've got to do this tune because I think it's been neglected and it will probably be a good seller. And we can do something with it. So we started out with Organ Grinder Swing as the focal point of the album. And everything else sort of evolved around that tune.
Thank you.
Find it easier to play in front of an audience or at a record date? Can you get off when you're playing at a recording?
Doesn't matter really, except when the audience is noisy, it's kind of difficult to use any subtlety, you know.
And you play a lot of ballads too.
Yeah, I like ballads very much, but you know, when you got all this distraction going on, it seems a waste when you try to do subtle things. But in the recording studio, it's nice. You can do what you want to do.
Do you think you can ever fully learn the guitar?
Well,
I mean, I think you have, but...
Yes and no. There's always something new to learn because the instrument is so... It's like a puzzle. There's so many different things you can do with such a small neck instrument with six strings and... Like, you got six strings across, and you got, say, 25, 30 frets one way, and across that is six strings. So you got a combination of things going on there. And out of that combination of squares,
There's
a million possibilities, so there's always new possibilities.
Some of it's really mathematical.
Well, I'm talking about it that way, but I don't mean it. But the point is, it comes out to be, there's always a new combination of places where you can put your fingers, and all of a sudden there's something new. So in that sense, you'll never learn it. It's not just what you do, but where you place it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you might have the same combination put in a different place somehow. But on the other hand, learning the guitar, or learning any instrument, is learning to do what you hear. So that's the other part, which transcends the instrument. It applies to any instrument, to be able to play what you hear.
You mean inside?
Yeah.
Be able to just go...
Yeah, if you hear that and you play it.
Uh-huh.
So, I think I'm getting pretty close to that part.
Don't think you got that yet?
No, there's always something you hear you can't do.
Uh-huh.
Because you're always hearing new things,
uh-huh,
fortunately.
You ever dream about it? You ever dream up new things,
I've done that in the middle of the night. I'm kind of a lazy sleeper. I think I've gotten up once to say, oh yeah, let me try this. Usually I don't get out of bed to Try something. I said, well, it'll keep till tomorrow.
You taught yourself guitar, right?
Well, I'm teaching myself guitar. I started out as a result of my family, my brothers, my older brother, Billy, who's playing bass with me, by the way, this week. He switched to bass about 10 years ago. He was a guitar player. My father was a banjo player, non-professional. And I wanted to be a saxophonist when I started, but there was little money around. The guitar was, and I guess still is, the cheapest instrument you can buy. So I condescended to getting a guitar. And
how much is a good saxophone now? A really high quality?
I don't know.
I know a good guitar is like $1,000.
Yeah, but you can get a guitar for $10 too in a pawn shop. And in fact, that's what my first guitar cost, $10. So I sort of started with that, and then the more I played it, the more I liked it. And then after about a year or so, I just said, well, okay, I'll go with this.
You never went back to sax then?
No.
Do you play anything else now? Fiddle around on piano?
Yeah, I fiddle around on piano, and I fiddle around on bass. I have a piano at home, which I use for writing and arranging. But the only thing I can say that I'm capable on is the guitar. Thank you.
That's one of my favorites of all time of yours. Don't mean a thing if it don't have that swing.
That's true.
Who's the other guitarist on that?
Barry Galbraith.
He's still around?
Yeah, he's working in the band on the David Frost show. That's his basic gig right now with Billy Taylor. And he still does a lot of studio work in New York.
It seems like a lot of musicians have switched over to that.
Yeah, I guess it's sort of security if you're going to stay in New York or Los Angeles. I guess it affords you a schedule also besides a paycheck when you can have some regulated time for yourself. Because just doing studio work, freelancing is like being a doctor, you know, where you...
You're kind of waiting for people to come to you.
Yeah, and you don't have any schedule and your life is all consistently inconsistent.
Well, that was a large period of your life, for say those 6 years when you were doing those Blue Note dates.
Oh yeah, that's what I was doing. And in 1960, I got so fed up with that erratic schedule that I took two Broadway shows. I did that for 3 years, just so I could have a schedule. I worked in the pit band. Plus I did record dates, but that was at least, I went to work every night at 8 o'clock and I finished at 11. And
you had a chart to follow, right?
Yeah. That was all right. I did a lot of reading and a lot of thinking there.
Uh-huh.
A lot of practicing. I thought of that as an incubation period for me because I really got my mind together while I was sitting there for those 3 years. Doing not much musically, but sort of thinking about what I wanted to do in the future. Then I proceeded to try to do it.
Have you heard John McLaughlin?
Yeah.
He has a lot of rock background.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily playing in public, but in private, do you ever try new things or some of the things that say he's doing or other, you know, do you ever try to play rock or?
Well, I've played rock on a lot of record dates, which you're probably not aware of. I've been doing that for a long time, you know, before it became an arty form of expression, and I say that in quotes. I see no sense in experimenting with things just in order to keep up. Like I said before, I'm not trying to keep up with it. I'm aware of it, and if I really feel something that I hear, maybe John will play, then I will do it, because that's my philosophy, you know. No matter where I've heard it or what its source, it comes out of me sort of like because I can't help it to come out. But I don't sit down and like, okay, well, here's a new puzzle, I'm going to work this out. I don't approach music that way. It's got to be like more feeling than anything else, for whatever that's worth. I don't know.
Well, what kind of rock dates did you do? Was your name not listed on the albums, things mm-hmm. that I wouldn't know about?
No, because I felt that it would, what's the word? It would confuse whatever image I had as a jazz player. And I knew that someday the two would get closer, and it'll probably get closer and closer, where, and I hope it will, then we can get rid of the labels.
Mm-hmm.
And like, so we're talking about John McLaughlin today as a rock guitarist. I don't know, maybe 5 years from now, there'll be a guitarist we'll be talking about, and we won't know what to call him, because the bridge will be completely there, it's solid. You know?
Closed, yeah.
Yeah. And I'm looking forward to that day, because I think a guy, if he can play, he can play. And we should really get rid of those labels.
Thank you. When you listen to somebody like, not jumping back too far, but jumping back to, say, Django Reinhardt or Charlie Christian or even some people used to play rhythm with Fats Waller, can you still get things out of them?
I get a lot of pleasure out of it and appreciation, understanding, and, well, from a musician's point of view, you get a lot of things from listening.
Uh-huh.
Those were some of my early influences.
Who else did you used to listen to that probably...
Well, you mentioned two, Christian and Reinhardt, Oscar Moore, who played with Nat Cole, was a big influence as far as guitar. Then there's a whole string of people that had nothing to do with guitar that influenced me. Art Tatum, for one, Miles, Bird, Duke Ellington, Dizzy. People I've worked with, John Coltrane. You influence all the time by things, and you see there's varying degrees of how much you will be influenced and how much you will influence in turn.
Well, I'm sure you've turned on a million jazz guitarists too.
I don't know about that, but if I have, I hope it's been a good thing. You know, whatever I mean by a good thing.
Well, you have a whole style of playing that, you know, sounds bluesy without, it has its own kind of thing. Like, you don't bend strings much. You get blues chords instead of bending strings.
Well, like I said before, that's my bent, right?
Right.
My bent is not too bent. But that's just a personal thing. Some people sound a certain way. Like, when we talk, music is almost like talking. Anyway. Uh-huh. Some people turn their words away a certain way, or they... And other people don't. That's their sound. You know?
Uh-huh.
And that's the way I hear it, so that's the way it comes out.
Thank you.
You ever get into any jam sessions? I know there's some musicians around New York who like to go around and cut other musicians.
I think that's old fashioned. Nobody does that anymore.
Do you ever used to participate in any of those sessions? Or?
Actually, that was a means of survival at one time. It's just a matter of, there were so many musicians around and everybody wanted a hearing. So it was your duty to try and sound better than the next guy so that you would get the job offer or whatever it was.
Now there's just not that much work, it seems. But
well, I think there's a lot of work, but I think really the criteria is not there. See, we had sort of a subculture thing in jazz, which is not there anymore. There's no criteria for anything, even in jazz, as you probably know. You can do anything on a record or anything in person. If you got an audience, then you're in business.
Yeah, if it'll sell.
Yeah, I'm saying if you got an audience, there's no need to cut anybody to prove anything. You got to just prove it to the audience. If they go for it, you're in business. It's kind of sad in a way, because I think musicians are important. The artists themselves are important to help set some standards. It's not just a matter of communicating with the audience. I think part of the responsibility of being a communicator is to teach and educate and enlighten as well as entertain.
Instead of just doing something which will bring you the easiest gratification.
Right, and instead of just doing something which will give you a reaction, which will get a reaction,
uh-huh.
Whether it be positive or negative, you know, to do, build something that you feel is positive and important as far as art, you know, music or art is concerned. And I think collectively the musicians are probably the best judges of that because they're more involved with it.
Do you have a chance to work out new things on your own? And
I'm always doing that.
And just sit around?
Because you can't help that if you leave yourself free. So you don't know what's going to come next to your mind. And if you attempt to do it, then you're going to automatically do some new things.
Yeah.
The problem is, though, with jazz playing and I guess rock playing or whatever, this music isn't written down. It's hard sometimes, like, you get a great idea and it's lost, it's gone, because it's not recorded. So you may never think of it again, you know. So if I could afford it, I'd have a tape on all times.
Check it out.
Yeah, I might play something. Wow, that was nice. You know, maybe write a song on it based on that little thing. But in the middle of a solo or something in a club on a given night, it's gone.
Last hour, you've been listening to an interview with guitarist Kenny Burrell. The program was recorded in San Francisco in the month of October 1970. This is Dan McClosky. Thanks for listening. Thank you.